And our next speaker will be Spencer Hoos, as President and CEO of ESCO Zodiac Corporation. Spencer, please welcome Spencer Hoos.
Okay, you've been sitting for a while. Maybe you want to stand up and stretch. Everybody wants to stand up and stretch?
I feel good standing up and stretching. Let me tell you, it's a lot easier. It's a lot easier to drive this continuous improvement from the top than from the bottom. I have been having a lot of fun for the last 7 years, but I've been active in continuous improvement since I first got out of college. I joined General Electric, and from day one, if you didn't perform and get a good rating, you didn't get a raise. So they taught you. Either go get it, or you don't get any money. So I'm going to talk about three things. First, I want to show you who we are, who's Engineered Arresting Systems Corp. And I'll talk a little bit about Lean and some of the things that we've been able to do. And then I want to show you a process that we have engaged in at getting everyone in the company, 220 people, actively involved in the performance improvement process through the utilization of a business software called SuccessFactors that allows us to have people put their objectives into this package, and any of the managers can drill down, and they've got to be smart objectives. So, I work for a French company, Zodiac Aerospace. It's about $2.5 billion in dollars. They are very active in the acquisition process. 80% of the businesses are commercial aviation, so we're an outlier. We're military products and airport, commercial airport products. But 8 years ago, the CEO wanted to diversify a little bit. He wanted to buy a military business, so he bought this business. There's six segments. I will tell you that I joined the company in 89. I was in the evacuation slide business. We started the lean journey there in 1992. One product that you're all familiar with is a life vest, pretty common stuff. We had 5% of the market. It took us 35 minutes to build a life vest, put a team on it. They said, we can't do any better. We said, well, you got old equipment. Look at it differently. We wound up reducing the time from 35 minutes to 9 minutes. 5 years later, we brainstormed better ways to do that. Took it down to 4 minutes. We were making 20,000 life vests a year when we started. Today, they're making between 250 and 300,000. They've captured the market. So, the corporation is worldwide. Better than 50% of the companies are in the U.S. Some businesses down in South America, Embraer in Sao Paulo, Brazil. They're all over Eastern Europe. Some companies in Northern Africa and South Africa. And then, of course, because we're a global company serving the airlines worldwide, we're in Singapore, China, Hong Kong, all over the Pacific Rim. That's a picture of our headquarters in Aston, PA. It's about 120,000 square feet. We have 120 people there. The company dates back to the 30s. One company was based in Newark, Delaware, All American Engineering. They made a product called a water twister, which is nothing more than a big tub with a baffle in it with some liquid that creates the resistance when an airplane catches the their tail hook on a cable. The other company made a mechanical brake called ADEC. They were merged in 1989 and then purchased by Zodiac Aerospace in 2002. We're international. We're everywhere. Everywhere they fly military aircraft, we're there. We don't have a lot of competition. We're also, for our other product, which is what we call EMOS, it's crushable concrete, it stops commercial airplanes from running off the end of runways. We're in China and Madrid so far internationally, but we're on about 50 runway ends. And I'll show you some pictures. So this is typical of a jet coming in and catching a tail hook. We manufacture the braking system. We manufacture the cable raising equipment. We manufacture nets. Most of our equipment is emergency arresting. That's the case where a pilot can't stop. There's a couple of these pictures. Give you a pretty good idea of what happens. So if a pilot's in trouble, he lets them know in a hurry. Once that cable raised. Okay, we also make mobile equipment. This is a Marine Corps right here. Fairly large, remember this fairly large pieces of equipment. This piece of equipment can arrest 20 aircraft an hour in a very short space, just like an aircraft carrier. That's a picture of our mechanical brake and another picture of an airplane taking the cable. We do our testing at Lakehurst. It's the only place in the world today that you can test this equipment. They have a 5-mile track over there, and they use a jet car that's got 4 jet engines on it. It pushes this truck down the rail track, and you have to stop it. Can be as much as 80,000 pounds, committed 70 or 80 knots. And when you first hear about our equipment, you think, well, it's the aircraft carriers. Well, there's only 16 aircraft carriers, so it's not a lot of business. But the Navy is changing. The Navy is going from steam-oriented equipment to electromechanical. The next aircraft carrier will have our equipment on it, and it's the Gerald Ford. So right now our equipment is in test at Lakehurst, but for those of you that do a lot of engineering, we're building the first ship set without having this equipment tested yet, so that's a little bit of a challenge. The other product is our EMOS. It's nothing more than concrete blocks that are aerated, very soft. You can stick your finger in it. And those blocks get assembled at the end of the runway. That's Cordova, Alaska. They're a little concerned about the weather up there. It's right by the water. No problem. That's been in place about 4 years. Here's some arrestments. JFK actually has had 3 arrestments. That one up on the upper left is a Saab 340 that came in at 70 knots. Stopped. No problems. Some damage to the propellers. The one on the right is an MD-11, wide-body aircraft that got stopped. The one on the bottom on the left is a 747, came in a snowstorm. Landed. Typically, the airplanes land deep in the runway, and it's not enough room to stop. And if there isn't, it's a short runway, there isn't a water or some embankment behind it, they're in big trouble. So that 747, the pilot didn't know there was a bed there, and he tried to turn the aircraft, and he slid into the bed because Thurston Bay is behind that runway. And when they got out, they still weren't sure what happened. They thought it was mud. They pulled that aircraft out and brought it into a hangar, cleaned it up, replaced 9 tires, and it flew 1 week later. Same company in Dusseldorf, Germany, the following Sunday night. Had a 747 aircraft come in, couldn't stop. Total loss of aircraft. The one on the right on the bottom is in Greenville, South Carolina. So here is an arrestment at Jaeger Airport. You'll see in a minute that the runway drops off about 400 feet. That's an Embraer aircraft that aborted takeoff and would have gone over the end. 33 people and 3 crew walked away. When we have to repair the bed, we just dig out those blocks that are damaged and replace them. So it's a pretty cheap replacement. There's Logan Airport, runs into the water. There's Jaeger Airport. You can see where the bed is. right here, drops off. That's probably a better picture over there. Binghamton, big drop off. Key West into the water, the mush. Greenville drops off. Groton, Connecticut, same problem. Look at Telluride. They built out that runway over the last 2 years so we could put that bed up there. And there's Taipei, Taiwan, same problem. Another product that we're into, UAVs are big deal now, lots of business. It's a growing business. We have a tremendous product for launching UAVs in the 300 to 800 pound range. And we're trying to capture that market. So the whole key here is people. It's all about people. If you can't encourage your people to get involved with you and drive performance improvement, you're in big trouble. So the first thing, we heard it before, build trust and respect. You know, how do you do that? Got to be involved. Got to lead from the front. When you start training, top people in the company better be the first ones trained. So we had 55 people. We used EVRC extensively, not only for lean, but we used them to facilitate strategic planning, and we've used them to do leadership training. We started out with 55 people. We went through 60 hours of training, started in September. By January, the training was over. People were formed into teams during their training. Each got assigned a project, and they had until May 15th or mid-May to finish their project. We shut the company down. They had to make a humorous presentation, and they got more humorous as the years went by. You should have seen some of these presentations. But we really want to know, what were you going to save? So the team that I worked on, we were working on standardizing hardware. I scratched my head and said, what are we going to save there? Did a value stream map and found out we had 11 suppliers. We were writing 500 purchase orders a year. I said, why do we need 11 suppliers? We always had 11 suppliers. Okay, suppose we had one. Suppose that supplier was certified and you didn't have to inspect the lots that came in. I asked the quality director, how long does it take to inspect a lot of hardware? 2.5 hours. 2.5 hours. So then we said, hey, suppose you don't even put this stuff in the stock room. You don't have to pull it out, put it back in bags, bring it out to the floor. The mechanic's got to search through the box for his parts. He loses them half the time. He goes back for more. Suppose we had can bins out on the factory floor. Suppose the mechanics went and got their own parts. Holy geez. We identified $400,000 in potential savings. I'm still waiting to get Kathy Gorman's here. She was our purchasing manager. Kathy, where are you? Hiding, yeah. She said she could get $75,000 out of that supplier. We're going to compete that material. It's about $800,000 a year in spare parts. So, next one, maintain customer and bottom line focus. Pretty important thing to do. Promote a collaborative environment, teaming, working together. Create a learning organization. I've got about 8 people going for their master's degree. We pay for everything. I want people to go to school. I want them to go to training. Support community service. Jeez, why is that up there? It's a good thing to do. Get your employees engaged. They feel good about that. We do a lot of small stuff, but we do support Children's Hospital of Philadelphia Triathlon. We send over 100 people down there in June, and we give out the water and direct the runners and the swimmers and the bikers. Utilize teams to drive continuous improvement. Everything we do is in a teaming environment. Keep employees up to date through continuous communications. Easy to say, hard to do. So we have a monthly all-hands meeting. We have regular other meetings during the month. We just recently started having celebrations because we have a lot of good stuff going on. We had an arrestment at Teterboro Airport on October the 1st. There were 10 people on board. Needless to say, they would have gotten pretty injured. So we decided, as part of the celebration, each employee would get a shirt, which they're going to wear proudly around home, which displays that aircraft in the bed. Provide promotional opportunities for employees. We job post every job in the company. Last year we had 19 promotions. Institutionalize reward and recognition. How many of you do rewards? Anybody out there do rewards, give away money? One, two, I can't get my managers to do it. What's the big deal for giving a $20 Wawa card? We're giving tickets to a movie. We're giving a $100 spot bonus. Get your big paybacks. People want to get engaged because they know if they volunteer and do more, they're going to get more. But you have to be creative in that respect. Develop robust processes. That's what Lean's all about. The opportunities really are in the office. The real opportunities are in the office. And then nurture innovation. We go a little bit crazy with innovation. I have a VP of engineering who, he's got a team called the Pit Crew. He likes to take them down to Disneyland to conference every year. We are getting lots of inputs in terms of ideas from the whole organization. So that's our culture. It's documented, it's communicated. Results. That's sales per employee since 2003. The last two columns are September and October. My guess is we're going to go to about 475 this year. Now that's a measure of productivity. As part of recognition, we had a corporate meeting out in San Francisco last week. We do this every December. I have to go to Paris to do this, and you might think, ooh, that's great, you go to Paris, yeah. You got to stay up all night, sleep on a plane. So we got recognized last week for having the highest EBITDA to sales ratio for the last fiscal year. So all of these things, and it's not me, it's a lot of people getting actively involved, produce tremendous results. And the one thing that I learned at the last company I was at, that after 8 or 9 years, you say, man, we're done. It's over. You can't do anymore. It ain't so. That's when you really see the opportunities. It may result in some investment, but the real opportunities come out later. One of the things I thought I'd never see. Our corporation has decided that everybody should go lean. But not only did they say that, they said you must hire a full-time continuous improvement director. And you must develop coaches that are going to spend 30% of their time on lean. For me, it's pretty easy to do that. But for the people that have never done it, that's a major task. And these are the things that they've asked us to do. They want to reduce inventory 50% over the next 5 years. They asked us a year ago to reduce our working capital 5%, and we did that. The whole corporation did that. They want to reduce cycle times 50%. Now, you saw the size of the equipment that we make, the arresting gear. My guy said, come on, you want to have a production line? You're crazy. We build this stuff, you know, 4 or 5 systems at a time in a batch mode. Okay. Well, you never tried it. So we got some dollies, we put these big fabrications on the dollies moved down the line, cycle time was reduced 50%. And on top of that, you get the productivity gains as you do that. So don't let a barrier stand in your way to making improvements. You have to see things differently. So they also want productivity increased 3% a year. They want us to reduce the defects 20% a year. I think all of those things can be done, but you got to work at it. So we do a strategic plan every 3 years. We just did this one off-site. 2 to 3 days. Our vision is to be the global leader mastering safety in motion. Our mission is to save lives, protect high-value assets. So we have 4 areas we're focused on: growth in adjacent markets and adjacent market penetration, products and services, people and culture, and cross-cutting systems. So I'm going to just show you each one separately. Under growth and adjacent market penetration, we're looking to grow our sales 10% a year. Under products and services, we want to accelerate growth through customer-driven and innovative products and services. That UAV launcher is just one of them. We know that we can stop automobiles and trucks. We were actually on the Discovery Channel. We built a product that could stop an 18-wheeler that allegedly was hijacked. We thought maybe we'd crush the cab. We thought maybe the truck would jackknife. It went in perfect. It stopped. No problems. But nobody wants to buy it. It's too expensive. Under people and culture, we want to promote a culture which demonstrates urgency for action, accountability for results, and forward-thinking practices. Under cross-cutting systems and processes, we want to upgrade internal operations, systems, organization structure, and processes to support our growth. Okay, here's the payback. You got all that. Now what are you going to do? How do you get it down to the people? We got lots of actions. We know the more people we get involved, the better we're going to do. So we came across, we actually had a team go through the Lean Champion training. They worked on our performance appraisal. I thought maybe they'd come back and say, let's scrap performance appraisals. We're doing okay without it. They came back and said, no, we got to work on objectives. We got to stop focusing so much on traits and characteristics. Okay, so we did some training on SMART objectives, but still, it's very difficult when you don't have an easy methodology to get at that. So this is success factors. These are the people who report to me. Here I am up there. These are my objectives from last year. I really want to focus on just this division sales. So you see my goal was to exceed budget by 5%. So now I'm going to go down to T-Lad Webb, where is he, over here, and then Peter Mayhall and their organizations. So here is T-Lad Webb, and there it is, same objective. Brian Stokes. Up here, works for T-Lad. There's his. Where is it? One of these is on sales. I don't see it, though. Oh, there it is. There it is. See the sales budget by 5%. So the whole idea here is to make sure that the people you want engaged on these objectives are focused and measured, and their bonuses all tie into that objective. So now I go to Peter Mayhall. There's Peter up here. We're going to look at one of his guys, Ken Thompson. There it is. These are his sales numbers for the year. Ken Thompson works for Peter Mayhall. There it is here. Achieve required bookings in time to meet the FY10 sales. And then we go down to one of the guys that works for him, and there's the same objective. So very simple tool, and it's not very expensive, I'll tell you that, but you got to work at this to allow you organizationally to drive your actions and initiatives down through the organization. Okay, that's it for me.